Here we are. There we are. Second Samuel. Samuel was one of my favorite books that I like to go back and read over and over again. And every time I find little gems, 2 Samuel 22:31 says, God's way is perfect. Not mine, I can tell you that for sure. But God's way is perfect. The Lord's promises always prove to be true. He protects those who trust in him. And then in Genesis, I trust in you for my salvation, O Lord, for I love you. I keep trusting the Lord. It's Melissa. Sure. I keep trusting my Lord as I sail go on. I just keep trusting my Lord as I sing a song.
Though the storm clouds darken the sky or the heavenly rain, I just keep trusting my Lord. He will never fail. He's a faithful friend. Such a faithful friend, I can count on him to the very end. Though the storm clouds darken the sky or the heavenly trail, I just keep trusting my Lord. Trusting my Lord, he will never fail.
When you walk with the Lord in the light of his word, what a glory he sheds on our way. Let us do his good will. He abides with us still, and with all who will trust and obey. Trust and obey, for there's no other way to be happy in Jesus but to trust and obey. Not a burden we bear, not a sorrow we share, but our toil he doth richly repay. Not a grief or a loss, not a frown or a cross, but is blessed if we trust and obey. Trust and obey, for there's no other way to be happy in Jesus but to trust and obey. Simply trusting every day, trusting through the stormy way, in when faith, thy faith is small, trusting Jesus, that is all. Trusting as a moment's flight, trusting as the days go by, trusting him, whatever. Trusting in Jesus, that is all. Preston, share with us God's word for today, would you please?
Ask and it will be given to you. Seek and you will find. Knock and a door will be opened to you. For everyone who asks receives. The one who seeks, and to the one who knocks, the door will be opened.
Amen. Give him a big hand. Thank you for that. God, but I love to hear our children share the Word of God, read the Word of God, participate in worship. Certainly, we continue to invest in that next generation. Amen? You know, down through the years, in fact, over two decades, we have come to understand as a pastor and people that great things happen when God's people pray. You know, I think back on three occasions, back in 2001 and 2002, when we were looking at expanding our facilities, doing a major renovation of this worship center, adding new space. The church at that time back then was divided over a direction of which way to go. Should we just do a patch-up job or maybe just a semi, you know, renovation or a full-blown thing? Well, I remember as we called the church to fast and pray, God's people within a very short time, a matter of a few months, came together in unity. Later on, in 2004, when we know we were facing one of the worst hurricanes that were ever to hit our area here in Pensacola, Florida, Hurricane Ivan, God's people began to pray again for protection, security, safety in the aftermath of the storm to help us get on our feet. But little did we know that as we fasted and prayed, God would, he would come down and end up using us, this church, to be an entire blessing to help the whole community here on the west side get on their feet. Great things happen when God's people pray. Then in 2008, when the great financial crisis hit, the housing crisis, the stock market, you know, started going down, money was tight, some of our members lost their jobs. Here we stood at that year with a debt of over $1,100,000. And of course, the budget that we still had to meet. People were hurting financially. What happened? Myrtle Grove Baptist Church, God's people got together, prayed and fasted, and with a matter of a few years and great day of giving, we retired a debt of over $1 million while maintaining our ministries here. You know, I've been here long enough to know, and many of you have too, that there is nothing that we can't accomplish when we're united in prayer. Now, as we know this year, we're facing another time of transition, a kind of a changing of the guard, I heard it put one time. A changing of the guard as one under-shepherd transitions and a new man comes in. Last year, we set aside a group of men and women, prayerfully, that would begin searching and seeking for that man that the Lord has already got in mind to become pastor here later on this year. I thought it would be great again, learning from our past, to collectively, though I know many of you have been praying, I certainly have, to pray again for those dear men and women. They're a part of that team. So I'm going to ask right now for all of the search committee members, men, ladies, gentlemen, if you'll come up and come right up here to the front, if you would, please. Stand, if you would, come down quickly and make your way here while they're coming. They've been working very hard and very diligently in seeking the Lord. So I want us to show them a solidarity of prayer right now. Because with the Lord, nothing is impossible. In fact, listen to the words of Jesus right here. In John's Gospel, chapter 14, Jesus said, I assure you that whoever believes in me will also do the works that I do, and he'll do even greater works than these, because I'm going to the Father. Whatever you ask in my name, I will do it so the Father may be glorified in the Son. If you ask me anything in my name, I will do it. So here's what I want. All of our ordained men, deacon, yoke fellows, former pastors, leaders, if you'll come down, please, quickly, gentlemen, ushers, yoke fellows, deacons, former pastors, and I want you to surround this group up here right now, if you would, please. Just kind of wrap a semicircle around them. And ladies and gentlemen, the congregation, if you would stand, please. And I want you, if you would, ladies and gentlemen, to take your right hand, right arm and extend it in their direction right now. And we're going to ask for God for a supernatural touch of encouragement, a blessing to work through these individuals right here, to bring about God's will, his perfect will for the church. Not man's will, not my will, God's will. And I want you to know before we pray, I have confidence in every and each and every one of these individuals right here. Their heart, their life, I love you. And I have total confidence as you seek God and you pray, the Lord is going to do exactly what we're asking right now, just like his word, like he promised in his word. Can I get an amen on that?
Amen.
Join me in prayer. Heavenly Father, in the name of Jesus, as we unite together our hearts, our voices, our mind, we have done this, Father, over two decades, nearly 22 years, Father, in my time, as pastor with this people, many whom are with you right now. Lord, we have been at challenging junctures along that journey. Yet everything, Father, we committed to you, everything we interceded for and fasted for, you did. And you always accomplished your perfect will and blessed your people here at Myrtle Grove Baptist. So with a united mind and heart, we pray, thy will be done. Do it mightily. Inspire, lead these ladies and gentlemen, Father, to your choice for the next under-shepherd servant leader. And we'll trust you for the results in Jesus' name. Amen.
Amen.
And amen. God bless you all. God bless you folks. Give these folks a hand clap. Encourage them a little bit right now. Encourage them. All right, Dick. You come on, brother, and lead us in a song.
If you find out where we are here. Stand up for Jesus. Stand up for Jesus. That's both an action and a song. We're going to sing this together. Here we are.
Stand up for Jesus, ye soldiers of the cross. Lift high his royal banner. It must not suffer loss. From victory unto victory, his army shall he lead. Till every foe is vanquished, and Christ is Lord indeed. Stand up for Jesus, stand in his strength alone. On a flesh will fail you, ye dare not trust your own. Put on the gospel armor, each piece put on with prayer. Where duty calls for danger, and stripper wanting there. There's a royal banner given for display to the soldiers of the King. As an ensign fair, we lift it up today, but are told to see. Marching on, for Christ count everything but lost. And to crown him king, toil and sink beneath the banner of the cross.
Brother Ken, Kevin, come and lead us in prayer, please, sir.
Good morning, everybody. Join me as we pray. Lord, we just come to you this morning, just asking your blessings on this church. In this upcoming year, that we may continue to be a beacon in this neighborhood and as we turn over a new chapter in the history of this church. And now I'd like to ask your blessings on this offering. Help us to give with a giving heart and help us to use this money to further your kingdom and do with it as you would have us to do with it. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Amen. Thank you.
Choir, well, congratulations, Myrtle Grove Baptist Church. We have surpassed our goal for the Lottie Moon Christmas offering. Praise God for that. Praise Him. You know, we join, as most of you know, some of you are new to this church, the Southern Baptist Churches, but in our efforts, we join and pool that money, our 10,000 plus, with some 44,000 plus churches just like this. Some mega churches, some this size, some smaller. Many smaller ones, but collectively, we're able to go ahead and support men and women, their families on fields around the world, blessing the nations. So as you know, this year our theme is what? Our theme is advancing the kingdom vision, anticipating God's movement. In this offering, and what we do every year, both not only for the international missions, but our national work here in the Americas, we are advancing, we're assisting to advance the kingdom to the uttermost parts of the world. There are still many language groups yet that still do not have the Word of God in their language. I believe some 100 plus. So the work still needs to be done. But keep praying. Along with your giving, I pray that you'll join my heart and pray for these wonderful folks, many of them that we know personally, sent from our church, that God will bless them in their work and that we'll see God's kingdom come. His will be done here on earth. Amen? Amen? All right, as we get ready to have this welcome time, I want you right now, folks, you stand and you give a big smile, warm welcome to those around you right now, if you would please, everybody. Amen.
is the time to worship. Come, now is the time to give your heart. Come, just as you are to worship. Come, just as you are before your God. Come.
One day.
One day every tongue will confess you are God. One day every knee will bow. Still the greatest treasures remain for those who gladly choose you now. And one day every tongue will confess you are God. One day every knee will bow. Still the greatest treasures remain for those who gladly choose you now.
Come.
Come. Now is the time to worship. Come. Now is the time to give your heart. Just as you are to worship. Come, just as you are before your God. Come,
now is the time to worship.
Come, now is the time to give your heart. Just as you are to worship. Come. Just as you are before your God. Come.
Amen, amen. You know, our God, He takes us out of places that we could never imagine that we could come out of on our own strength. God is the only one who could do the unthinkable, the impossible. He makes it possible. So on our own strength, we try to get out of places that we are unable to, but only God is. He is the one that gives us that life, that new life, that living hope for us to rise again and shake it off, and whatever, no matter what it is, no matter what happened, what we've been through, where we at, He gives us that new hope, that new life. But it's only on Jesus Christ. Only Him is the one that gives you that. You know, not on our own strength, not our own flesh, but God. He gives us the new hope, the new living hope. And how great the chasm that laid between us. How high the mountains I could not climb. In desperation, I turned to heaven and spoke your name into the night. Then through the darkness, your loving kindness tore through the shadows of my soul. The work is finished, the end is written. Jesus Christ, my living hope. Who could imagine so great a mercy? What heart could fathom such boundless grace? The God of ages stepped down from glory to wear my sin and bear my shame.
cross was broken, I am forgiven. The King of Kings calls me his own. Beautiful Savior, I'm yours forever. Jesus Christ, my living hope. Hallelujah, praise the one who set me free. Hallelujah, death has lost its grip on me. You have broken every chain. There's salvation in your name, Jesus Christ, my living hope. Hallelujah, praise the one who set me free. Hallelujah, death has lost its grip on me. You have broken every chain. There's salvation in your name, Jesus Christ, my living hope. Sealed the promise, your buried body began to breathe. Out of the silence, the roaring lion declared, the grave has no claim on me. Then came the morning that sealed the promise. Your buried body began to breathe. Out of the silence, the roaring lion declares, the grave has no claim on me. Jesus, yours is a victory. There's salvation in your name, Jesus Christ, my living hope. Hallelujah, praise the one who set me free. Hallelujah, death has lost its grip on me. You have broken every chain. There's salvation in your name, Jesus Christ, my living hope. Jesus Christ, my living hope. Oh God, you are my living hope.
Wow. Heavenly Father, we give you praise today. For Lord, you certainly deserve all the praise, all the honor, and all the glory. Father, as you've spoken so powerfully through song, prayers, speak now through your holy word. In the blessed name of your Son, Jesus, we pray and ask these things. The people of God said, amen and amen. You may be seated. If you've been with us the last few weeks, you know that we're doing a series of messages on the kingdom. We're focusing on this morning on the subject when God's people, kingdom people, quit caring. You know, folks, there is great meaning to names. In fact, names stand for something. We associate names with certain events or characteristics. If you hear the name Lee Harvey Oswald, for example, we immediately, our minds, go to November 22nd, 1963, to the assassination of President Kennedy. Or if you hear the name Hitler, or you hear the name Stalin, we immediately think of the worst forms of hatred, an abuse of power, the attempt to exterminate large numbers of people. And what about in the Old Testament, names like Jezebel or Judas? Who names their kids Jezebel? You know, or we don't do that because names mean something, you know, not only for individuals, but for groups. You think of the Vikings historically, or more recently here in American history, the Ku Klux Klan. Instantly, our minds realize, you know, what the implications of a name is. They can stand for good, for evil. You know, God chose Israel to make a name for himself, that Israel would be a showcase people, redeeming, in order to make a name for God, blessing them, that they could go ahead and bless the nations. You go back to the promise that God gave to Father Abraham, that through your seed, the nations would be blessed. So he built a kingdom people to go ahead and bring glory to his name, to draw other people to Yahweh, to the one true God. But instead, they became, instead of a blessing and honoring God's name, they became a slap in God's face. The nation uniquely blessed by Almighty God failed to live up to her divine calling. And as a result, they became a reproach. They profaned his name in broad daylight. The result of their disobedience, as a result, this pagan superpower at that time in the Old Testament called Babylon were able to come in and conquer Israel and take her in like cattle, leading them into captivity. I want us to take a look at God's Word today. If you have your Bibles, you're welcome to open them. If you don't, you can read along. The words will be on the screen. But we're going to be looking this morning at a very powerful, powerful book and two powerful chapters. Turn, if you would, to Ezekiel chapter 36. In the Old Testament, the book of Ezekiel, chapter 36, we're going to begin reading at verse 20. If you would stand with me, folks, in honor of the reading of the Word of God. Listen to the prophet's words here, referring to Israel. When they came to the nations where they went, they profaned my name, because it was said about them that these are the people of Yahweh, yet they had to leave his land in exile. Then I had concern for my holy name, which the house of Israel profaned among the nations where they went. Therefore I said to the house of Israel, this is what the Lord God says, it is not for your sake that I will act, O house of Israel, but for my holy name, which you profaned among the nations where you went. I will honor the holiness of my great name, which has been profaned among the nations, the name you have profaned among them. The nations will know that I am Yahweh, for the declaration of the Lord God, when I demonstrate my holiness through you in their sight. Father in heaven, we pray today that you would speak to each heart here, including my own, even as I preach. Lord, that we might understand the importance of obedience, the importance of making your name great. As your kingdom people, teach us, Father. Lead us. In Jesus' name, amen. You may be seated. You can almost imagine at that time in Israel's history, here they had the blessings of God, the words of God, and the power of God resting on them, and yet they took advantage of it. They took it for granted and turned to other things, to immorality, to other gods, and as a result were led away into captivity from the beloved holy city of Jerusalem that was left in ruins, destroyed by the Babylonians. City walls broken down. Here they are in chains being led away, ashamed, realizing, I'm sure, what got them there. Yet at the same time, what do you think about God? What do you think the nations thought about them? But what do you think about our God today by watching us? What do you think God is saying right now when he sees the church in America and a church that just a half a century ago, for the most part, the majority of the Americans believed in God, believed in the Bible as being God's authoritative word? Of course, we're not naive to think that everybody lived by it. Certainly not. Sin prevailed then as it does now. But at least the nation collectively as a whole had honored God's holy word and the history that we had. But what about now? What do you think God thinks when he looks down on us? You know, see, we're much like Israel. This is why when we read these words, we can't help. When we read these chapters and other chapters throughout the Old Testament, we can't help but identify with Israel in her own shame. For we too, like Israel, have been redeemed from slavery. I mean, think about this. Here was the people of God that the Lord set free from Egyptian captivity, led them in the wilderness to the promised land. And much like Israel, we were in bondage, not to Egypt, but our own form of Egypt. It's called sin. We were in bondage of sin, and yet through the Calvary's cross and the great work that God did, because he so loved the world, giving his only son, we were set free from captivity. And yet, like Israel, often, you know, we make these commitments to God, as they did, that they're going to obey. Remember the commitment they made to Joshua? At the end of his life, we will obey God. We will follow him. He'll be our Lord. You know, Joshua made that famous statement that many of you have on plaques on your doors, in your home, or inside your house in the entryway. As for me and my house, we will serve the Lord. How many of us, after our own conversion experience, make commitments like that? Yeah, Lord, I'm going to follow you. I'm going to serve you. And yet, like Israel, we would allow ourselves to be led astray, you know, to some other, you know, form of Babylon. You know, they are led in captivity to their Babylon. You know, we have different kinds of Babylons that seduce us and lead us away from our initial commitments as God's kingdom people. You know, Israel had tossed away as if unwanted, you know, tossed away in their backside the blessings of God, only to receive as a result of that his corrective judgment. Jeremiah said of Israel at that time, in Jeremiah 32, verse 21 through 23, he said, God led them to a land flowing with milk and honey. They entered it, possessed it. But even after all of this, they did not obey your voice or live according to your law. The words in the Holman Standard, but even after all of this. What happened to the majority of Israel at that time? Folks, they quit caring. They took the blessings of God for granted. They allowed themselves to drop their guard spiritually, and as a result were seduced by the pagan culture of their time. It doesn't take a big stretch of the imagination to look at America right now and realize that the generations, even children that were raised in Christian homes, you know, or going back a generation or two, were seduced by the pagan and by the prosperity, if I may, one thing, and by a pagan and moral pagan culture in this country, and led away into captivity. That sin brought about the breakup of homes. You know, you look at the state of marriages and families in the country right now, divorce. It's incredible. But we are much like Israel. This is why in reading the Old Testament and you know, looking at some of the lessons that are there, we've got to remember when we're dealing with Israel, God's word, his character, is the same back then, yesterday, as it is today, and will be till the time he comes again to set up his own kingdom here on earth. Friends, in the meantime, here we are, having to learn from the history that we don't repeat it. You know, those who don't learn from history, you've heard it said many, many times, I'm sure, by different people, we're doomed to repeat it if we don't learn the lessons of the past. And I believe God placed these in our holy writ, the Holy Scriptures right here, that we would learn from them and realize. Well, one of the things, I mean, right there, yet even in the face of God's punishment, while they're in exile and captivity in Babylon, that is the southern kingdom, Judah, yet even in the face of all that punishment and regret, there were signs of hope and life. We find it right here in Ezekiel, the prophet's words that we're going to be reading here in just a few verses down from the verses that I read previously. We find this glimmer of hope. What we find, dear friend, is what we find in our own life and journey as new covenant kingdom people. That's what we are, you know. We're under the new covenant, but we're God's kingdom people, as Israel were long ago. And what they found there in the character of God is what we experience in our life today. It's called grace, G-R-A-C-E, God's amazing grace. He was there to go ahead in spite of everything they did, disregarding the things of God. Over and over again, not learning from their mistakes. Yet we see God's heart here. Look at Ezekiel chapter 36, verse 26. Key verse here. He says, and this is, getting your strength back. You know, I mean, if you're beaten down, if you're there right now, You know, in living in disobedience, you know, only in your own heart and mind, you know, where you stand with God. You know, all of us from time to time have failed, have broken promises that we made to our Lord. But if you're there right now, listen to these words. In verse 26, Ezekiel, speaking for God, says, I will give you a new heart and put a new spirit within you. I'll remove your heart of stone. Listen to that phrase. I'll remove your heart of stone and give you a heart of flesh. I'll place my spirit within you, Now, that's interesting. That's certainly prophetic. For all in the Old Testament, prior to the day of Pentecost, the Spirit came down and rested upon men and women in the Old Testament under the Old Covenant. But here he says, I'll put my spirit within you, projecting, prophesying of a time in the future, certainly looking to the day of Pentecost, when things would change and become new. I'll put my spirit within you and cause you to follow my statutes and carefully observe my ordinance. Well, here we see the hand of God. I mean, Israel by this time, can you imagine? There they are in captivity in Babylon. I'm sure, you know, realizing what got them there, they realized they ignored God's warning of the prophets he sent to them. They knew they had disobeyed God, stubbornly sat by while their hearts became cold as stone. They were aware that their national upheaval, their loss of freedom, their spiritual heart attack had been a result of years of rebellion. Babylonian captivity had indeed become a humbling blow for these people. Have you ever been humbled? You know, you turned your away from God, even if it was momentarily or for a short period of time, went your own way, only to be smacked down by life. It can be so cruel at times. And you find yourself like Israel, humbled, realizing what got you there. If you've been there, and I've been there in my own journey over the years looking back, I'm sure you have, if you've been a believer long enough, you realize how that feels. And here again, the hand of grace, as it was given to Israel, you know, by God, reaches down to us as well. You know, God's kingdom shines in moments like these. Just when the enemy, Satan, thinks that he slammed the door shut for good on the life of God's people, his kingdom people, either you as an individual or a church, just when he thinks he has the upper hand, in the middle of this crisis, God steps in. And with Ezekiel's words, steps forward to declare God's intention to revive his people. You see, what we're reading here, friend, is what we're witnessing in these verses, as chapters, is what happens when God revives us from our own rebellion. Not just Israel. We learn from their story. But it's speaking to our hearts today. When we rebel, when we become complacent, when we take for granted the blessings of God in our life, you know, just kind of ho-hum, become complacent, apathetic, and begin to have a cold heart rather than a warm heart. You know, I think some of the ways that you can measure that is, when have we had a burden for someone lost, a burden so great, and not just a family member, someone we may know, an acquaintance, maybe a neighbor, somebody that we're working with, a coworker. When have we had such a burden for someone who's lost that we feel, you know, a breaking in our own heart, wanting desperately to do anything that we can do to help reverse that situation, to be an instrument and a tool in God's hands. You know, it's interesting how, you know, so many times our hearts just certainly can grow cold. You know, the long night in Babylon for Israel would mark a turning point in their life. God allowed them to be sent in his permissive will, chained, a defeated people. Only now, Ezekiel said, was he planning to bring them out, a renewed, revived, more humble, but more obedient people with a heart and passion for God, like they once had under the reign of Joshua or King David in his good years, or even in the beginning of Solomon's ministry. God, Ezekiel was prophetically saying there is going to be such a time. The promise of restoration was there. God's plan to vindicate his name among the nations. And by the way, you know, keep in mind that God wasn't just only interested in one group of people. He certainly had a chosen people that he was raising up with Israel. We understand that. But he was raising them up for the purpose of touching all the rest of the nations. It was always his heart. Even we find in Genesis chapter 12, in his words to Abraham, that your seed from your seed, you, the chosen people, my people, the nations of the world would be blessed. God's heart for all humanity, all nations. We see it alive there in the Old Testament, and under the New Covenant, we see that with the Great Commission. when Jesus would say to us in the closing chapter of Matthew's gospel, therefore go. Go, just don't stay in a holy huddle. You know, we call this Sunday morning, this is a holy huddle right here. You know, mostly all God's folks huddling together. But not for the purpose of just patting each other on the back and feeling good for an hour on Sunday morning, but rather it's always been God's purpose that he blesses us and uses us to touch the nations around us. My friend, the nations have come to America in this melting pot, even in our own community. You know, I think about we have Vietnamese, Filipino, Hispanic, African-American, a bunch of white people from all over Europe. I mean, it's a melting pot right here. The nations have come to our land. And God's intention is to use his kingdom people, to bless the nations. How do we do that? We bring the good news of the gospel to them, marching ahead. Well, God's plan to vindicate his name back then was to do a physical act of restoring the exiles to the promised land, to their beloved Judah and their beloved city, Jerusalem, whose walls and the buildings have, you know, been torn down. They were crumble in ruins. And yet God, we know, divinely working through other pagan kings that have conquered Babylon, other kingdoms like Persia, would work through these pagan kings to give them a heart for God's chosen people, to even protect them. And then through people that we know like Nehemiah and Ezra, godly Jewish leaders, through all of that, God would lead his people back to the very beloved city of Jerusalem. See, Jerusalem was more than just a geographical place on the map. For the Jews, it was the very heart of their life. For them, it was the heart of their life. And God began that process of restoration back historically at that time to show his might and power, his mercy and grace. But, you know, we understand here, this side of the cross, that Israel, after a period of time, would once again rebel, turn away from God. By the time Jesus came on the scene, he would say to the Pharisees, he would call them, you know, whitewashed walls, scribes, Pharisees, hypocrites, because again, they were worried about the outward appearance, but their heart had grown cold. The compassion and love for the Lord was replaced with rituals and all outward appearances of holiness, but inside, they were filthy rags, our Lord said. Well, when we think about this vision that was being projected by Ezekiel, we realize that where Israel failed, God was going to create a new kingdom people. Now, we talked about this last week. You know, when Jesus said in his own earthly ministry, there is Caesarea Philippi upon this rock. Remember that verse last week? Jesus pointing to himself, the cornerstone. Upon this rock I will build my church, a new kingdom people. Where Israel failed, the church will pick up. And they will be a blessing to the nations. You see, here we are 2,000 years, this side of the cross, and the gospel has went out literally around the world with over 1 billion people that confess his name today on this planet. Indeed, the church became the kingdom people to carry, to march ahead, to advance the kingdom to the uttermost parts of the world. Our, you know, offering, why I celebrate that so much. You know, we set a goal to do our part, to collect money, to make sure that we put men and women on the field around the planet in every nation, every corner, so the good news of the gospel can be heard. It was Jesus himself who said, until the kingdom has been preached in every corner of the globe, once that's done and complete, then the Son will come, the Son, S-O-N, and he will set up his earthly kingdom here. You listen to Ezekiel. Man, through his words and phrases, he still have power to reach into the living room of our heart, our own troubled souls. Listen to what he says here. Speak a word and tell us things that will encourage our hearts even today. Let me say before we get into this portion of looking at these prophetic words, you may have walked in this building today, in this worship center, and you got beat up out there this week. I mean, people can be cruel. They can be cruel. Life can be cruel. And you may be feeling real low right now, or maybe it was due to your own rebellion, something that you failed to do. It's one thing to profess with our lips our belief in our Savior. It's another thing to actually live out his precepts, his teaching in our life. Maybe you're feeling right now a need for spiritual renewal. I want you to hear Ezekiel's words. Look at Ezekiel chapter 36, verse 25. In fact, let's read this together, would you? The prophet Ezekiel says, I will, say it folks, cleanse you. I will cleanse you. I mean, the encouragement given here, I'll cleanse you from all your iniquities, from all your idols. You know what a cleansing is? Well, back then, it would speak very powerfully to the Jews. It would reflect the ceremonial cleansing to get all the filth off their body, for special holy days. But this was going deeper than that. Ezekiel was saying, this cleansing that we need has got to get rid of all the filthiness and all the dirt in our own hearts. Hearts that have become dirty, had been contaminated from that time of rebellion. You know, in 1 John chapter 1, verse 9, under the new covenant, the Bible tells us that God is faithful, that if we confess our sins, you know this verse? If we confess our sins, he is faithful and righteous, and he will forgive us of all of our sins and cleanse us. There's that word again, and cleanse us from all unrighteousness. In other words, no matter what the dirt is in our heart, no matter how badly we have been contaminated, God can do a deep cleaning action that will set us free. Listen, he sets us free from the guilt that we have as a result of our disobedience. I tell folks one sure way, because I have people over the years ask me, man, how do I know if I'm a Christian? I don't really know. I ask them this question. I said, when you sin, do you feel guilty? Do you feel guilty? A sure way to know that you're a child of God is you feel deep conviction and guilt when you sin. You see, when sinners, lost people sin, you know, they delight in it. When a believer sins, he despises it. He loathes it because he realizes, if you're truly a born-again child of God, that what you've done or allowed the enemy to do in leading you into some captivity of some Babylonian addiction or problem or sinful attitude or action, you realize. And the guilt that comes on, it's that guilt that God can cleanse us from. See, when the inspired writer, the Apostle John, wrote those words that I just quoted there in 1 John chapter 9, he wasn't writing to lost people. And it wasn't writing to people that lost their salvation because they sinned. Friend, once you're saved, truly saved, you can never lose what God gives you because you never earned it. You never worked for it. It was a gift. But what he's saying is that sin brings about a dirtiness of our heart. It breaks our fellowship with God. And what restoration does is when we confess, when we repent. What's repentance? Repentance is a change of mind. Literally a change of attitude, a change of thinking, a change of direction. When we repent, then it opens up the floodgates for the Lord to do his work. That cleansing work to remove the guilt, take away the guilt, renew our spirit, put us on a solid footing again so we can continue to march and advance the kingdom work. And then our story that we tell is of a graceful and loving God who can truly do all of that. God's word purifies us. Listen to the second thing that he says here in verse 26. Let's read this one together. I will give you, say it with me, I will give you a new heart. The restoration for his people, he doesn't stop with just cleansing. It's one thing to remove our sin. It's another thing to heal and revive our spirit. That's exactly what God does. He gives us a new heart. Takes away that heart of stone. Have you ever had a heart of stone? You know, perhaps maybe during those periods of time of rebellion, you pick up God's word or you hear a preacher preaching, or hear it on the radio, and somehow it just doesn't move you. You know, you're not moved. It makes no sense. You feel that it's dull, boring. It's not speaking to your life. Friend, let me tell you, when you have a dirty heart, a dirty mind, that's what happens. We become dull to the Word of God. So God not only cleanses us and gets us ready for something very special, he gives us a brand new heart, removes that heart of stone. You know, you might be sitting here right now, you know, kind of fidgety. You see others taking in the Word of God. Man, I'm just not there. You don't feel right. It might be time right now to cry out to the Lord, as those did in the day of Nehemiah and Ezra. Oh, Lord, give me a new heart, as David did when he says what? David said, Lord, give me a new heart. Place your spirit, give me a new heart. A heart that will love you. David ended up being called, even after his discretions and his failure with Bathsheba, he still is called a man after God's own heart. He turned to the Lord, had his guilt removed. You know, we need a heart transplant. And when we talk about heart, we're not just talking about one vital part of the body that we need to live. Friend, for the Bible uses that term heart to refer to both our mind, our emotions, our spirit. It's all of that. It's the entirety, you know, of who we are. And when we receive that new heart of flesh, God's then able to shape and move as a physician, the great physician, and begin to restore us and place us again in a spirit of revival, of love, and of passion. There's a third thing he did. Look in verse 27, okay? Verse 27, God promises, and this gets better and better here, okay? He said, I'm not only going to cleanse you, I'm not only going to give you a new heart and a passion to serve me, but I'm going to place my spirit inside of your body. Now, we understand, again, theologically, this was a vision Ezekiel was having, not so much for Israel then, as it was going to be for the church later on. His spirit would come to live inside of our body and give us the power to be obedient. See, the problem is, there's a lot of sincere people that love God. You know, Israel, even at its best moments, when it loved the Lord, it struggled to carry out God's precepts, to be obedient to the Lord. We can't live a kingdom person life without the empowering of God's Holy Spirit that lives inside of our body. If there's anything beyond conversion, okay, that we need to understand, it's the working of the powerful Holy Spirit inside of us, what he's been placed in there to do. You know, the question's been asked over the years. You know, I mean, if God loves us so much, why didn't he just take us home? You know, leave this planet filled with evil and hurt and hatred, all the stuff that we see going on around us. Man, I just want to go home to heaven. Friend, the reason why God has not raptured the church yet and taken us up, like described in 1 Thessalonians in chapter 4, is that there's a lot of work yet we have to do down here, okay? Because he still loves the lost people that are out there. It's not just a matter. It's not only about us and how we feel. It's about his kingdom and his vision for the kingdom work. We're here to be a blessing to the nations who are still lost, millions of them. And just think of the millions in our own country right now that are lost and searching in the mass of confusion that we find ourselves in now. It's a vision for the future. Let me share with you the vision that follows in chapter 37 of Ezekiel. Listen to this. He said, the hand of the Lord was on me. He brought me out by a spirit and set me down in the middle of a valley. It was full of bones. He led me all around them. There was a great many of them on the surface of the valley, and they were very, very dry. Then he said to me this question, son of man, can these bones live? And I replied, Lord God, only you know. And he said to me, prophesy. Now that's another word like preach. What he was saying, preach. Preach, Ezekiel, concerning these bones. Say to them, dry bones, hear the word of the Lord. This is what the Lord God says to these bones. I'll cause breath to enter you and you will live. I'll put tendons on you, make flesh grow on you, cover you with skin. I'll put breath in you so that you could come to life. Then you'll know that I am Yahweh and my name is great. So I prophesied as I heard, as I had been commanded. While I was preaching, there was a noise, a rattling sound, and the bones came together. Remember that song, Knee Bones Connected to the... Yeah. Remember that one? You know, see, in this vision, all these skeletons, all these bones coming together. And then he goes on. Flesh grew on them, covered them, but there was no breath in them. And he said to me, preach to the breath. Preach, son of man. Say to it that this is what the Lord God says. Breath, come from the four winds and breathe into these slain, that they may live. So I prophesied as he commanded me, and breath entered them. And they came to life and stood on their feet, a vast army. Now I'm thinking, I read this passage over and over again, and about 10 times last night this morning. I mean, think about this for a moment. Indeed, this is a vision. It's undisputed that this was a vision not so much for Israel. Again, the Spirit living inside of us, living within us, can only point to the church. This is the church. And of course, at Pentecost, it began, and now down through church history, there have been the ups and the downs of the bride of Christ. But think about this. If you're feeling kind of low right now, and you don't see yourself in that vision and that vast army as part of his kingdom people, I want you to know the one who can fix you. Listen, please, dear friend, my dear friend, please listen to me. The one who can fix you is in this very room as I speak. Did you hear what I said? He is here right now. Jesus is here. He can fix you. He can give you. He can give you the cleansing that you need. He can give you the new heart, the passion, and take that heart of stone and put his love, inject his love in it again, and give you a heart to follow him, to serve him. Then he can give you the power of his Holy Spirit. Now, some of you are Christians. You got the Spirit, but the Spirit is grieved inside your body. To reignite the Spirit, life, and power in you again requires us to experience what Ezekiel's talking about, what God gave him in this vision. You know, when I look outside of our doors right here, I said earlier, all the nations have come to our shores. All the nations are here in America. Now, we're supporting our missionaries in places around the world that many of us will never go. But, dear friend, the nations are here in our own community. And here's Myrtle Grove Baptist Church. Man, I love this church. I love this church. I love it. I love you. I love the history. I love my memories that I have here. But I love you, the people of God, here right now, this year. And here's the vision. What I just read is what I'm praying for, selfishly, for my own church family. I believe in the future of Myrtle Grove Baptist Church. I believe in it. I believe in it. Because I know the character of what's really deep down inside of so many of you and my leaders, the leadership that are here right now. I know your heart, your love. Friends, we have the power. That's the good news. We just read in God's holy writ right here in the scripture. We've got the power. God's given us the gift of the Holy Spirit. We can get the heart. We just read on the road to restoration here. I mean, if you're a neutral friend right now, just kind of waiting to see what's going to happen. I told my ministry team, Walt Dick and the guy, I says, man, we don't stay in neutral while you're waiting for a change into the guard. Okay? You need to kick it into gear, friend. We need to kick it into gear. We've got some exciting opportunities right before us here. And this year could be one of the greatest years. But it's going to require a spiritual surgery for some of us. And allowing the Lord to do in our heart what he maybe perhaps has never done in your Christian experience. Or if you're not a believer, then step number one is to go ahead and embrace, open up the door to your heart. You know, it's got to travel. You say, well, I always kind of believe in God. Well, friend, it's got to travel from your head down to your heart. Down to your heart. Open up the door to your heart, which is your entire being. It's all of you, mind, soul, spirit. And let the Holy Spirit and the power of God come in. I pray my prayer is that God will take the Myrtle Grove family into great, great days ahead, becoming a light, a continuing light and powerful force in the west side here of Pensacola, Florida. The best is yet to come for those who believe. And it's a matter of true belief in everything that we just learned here in God's holy word. Stand with me if you would, please. This is God's invitation time. And I'm going to ask you, friend, just to focus in. Christians, pray. If you don't have to leave because of physical, whatever it might be, stay right here. One of the most important times is when we respond to God's word as a people of God. If the Lord's speaking to your heart today, if there's a decision that you need to make, if you're looking for, you've been looking for a church home, some of you, maybe this is the day to say, you know what? I'm locking in my life with this body of believers right here. I want to journey. I want to help advance the kingdom. I want to anticipate the power of God's movement within the life of Myrtle Grove. If that's your heart, you want to come down and simply say, Pastor, you know, I want to become part of God's family through my faith in Jesus. Or maybe you're already there and you're a church member. Maybe it's coming down with a family member and just renewing your commitment to advance the kingdom, to get out of neutral, kick it into gear, and begin finding a place where you can work and serve the Lord with your gifts, your talents. God's placed us here for a reason bigger than ourselves. It's bigger than my life, bigger than your life. The kingdom of God, his purposes, it's got to be top shelf. It's got to be top shelf. Remember what Jesus said? Seek ye first the kingdom of God and his righteousness and all these other things you're worried about. Are you worried about stuff? All these other things will be taken care of. They'll be added. God will take care of it. But seek the kingdom first. Heavenly Father, I pray in the name of Jesus, Lord, that you would work mightily now in each of our hearts. Begin working, Father, in my own heart as under-shepherd. Lord, I want to, whatever time I have remaining here, to be an encouragement, a blessing, to be used by you to help fortify and move these kingdom people that you've entrusted in my care for all these years to move this group, Father, to forward, to advance your kingdom work. Blessed, I pray in Jesus' name. Amen. Dear friends, I'll be standing right down here in front. You might want to come and just have a prayer with me. You might want to come privately, maybe with a family or friend. Or if you come and do unite, just take my hand and say, man, I'm ready to become part of God's family. I'll be here, Walt, others will be here in front of you as God leads you. You come right now.
Just as I am without one plea, but that thy blood was shed for me, and that thou biddest me come to thee. Of God I come, just as I am at waiting not to rid my soul of one dark blot to blood can cleanse its spot. Oh, Lamb of God, I come.
This is we pray silently here in our hearts. Father, I'm grateful, Lord, for your powerful healing hand, for the work that you're going to do in any of our lives, not judging us for what we've done or failed to do, but forgiving us when we come in true repentance, restoring us, Father, again, to full kingdom service. I praise your holy name this day. Thank you in advance, Father, for what you're going to do with the Myrtle Grove family as the months move on, as changes come. Father, help us to remember your mighty hand of power is the answer. Always has been, always will be. In the name of your Son, Jesus, amen. Amen. Put your hands together. Give God praise today. Amen. You may be seated. I want to introduce a couple friends that just last week came and expressed their desire to be members. David McDonald. David, where you at? But come on up here, David. This young man right here has been coming for about 8 weeks now. Was, in fact, his teacher is this wonderful lady right here, Alicia McFarlane. David said that under her teaching and her group that that David felt a definite need to give his life to the Lord, wants to be baptized and grow in faith. And so I want you to welcome this brother. All right, David. Stay right here, buddy. Also, Ulysses Barnett. Ulysses, where are you at, good buddy? Ulysses, there he is. Come on down, Ulysses. Ulysses has been a believer for some time. He lives here not far, right here in the Myrtle Grove area. Was going to his uncle's church over in Foley, but now at a stage right now where he can't make that long trip anymore, was looking for a place where he could worship and call his home base. So we've chatted. He knows the Word, a solid guy, loves God. But he said, you know, this is a church where the Word is taught and preached. This is where I need to be, plant my life, begin to grow in the grace of God. So by statement of his faith, he's coming as a member. Welcome, Ulysses. The name, it's not Ulysses. It sounds like Ulysses, but it's Ulysses. It's a very unique, Ulysses. Ulysses Barnett. So we praise the Lord for you guys. May God bless you richly. Ulysses, you got plugged into a small group this morning. And, of course, he's already got his group at Elisa. So if you see these guys going out before you leave, give them a handshake, okay? And welcome them to the family of faith. Everything else, I believe, is Chris. Chris got some words for us. You guys can take a seat right up here in front, okay? There you go.
All right, just a couple of things. So one of them that is not printed for you is there are still outstanding work orders through disaster relief through Hurricane Michael. And the next Saturday, there's a possibility of taking a group over to the Panama City area to help out again with some of the folks that are still suffering from the lingering effects of that. So if you are interested in going on that next Saturday, please call the church office and talk to me, or you can speak with Rondell Yeomans. Rondell's not here this morning, but most of you know who he is. But if you get in touch with one of us this week, we'd be glad to fill you in. Also, again, just want to remind our leadership team folks, this afternoon, 5:30 in the Fellowship Hall, we've got dinner, and then we've got meeting afterwards. And I know you've got an email about that this week with the agenda. So I hope you'll be here for that as well. Also, 2 weeks from today, our Sunday School leadership will be having a lunch after church on the 27th. Again, we'll be looking forward to our Steve Hale event and a spiritual awakening event, and how our small groups can be involved in helping with that and being ready and prepared for that event when it comes. So again, I just hope our leadership will be planning to attend on the 27th. Thank you, Walt.
Good morning, church family. Coming up on February the 8th, that is a Friday night, one of our worship teams led by Grace will be having a worship night. It'll be here in this very room, and I just want to encourage you to come join us for that time of worship. It's pure prayer and worship. There's really no preaching, just a couple of words of encouragement here and there, but I'm very excited about that. Jonathan and led by Grace, we'll be putting that worship night on coming very soon. If you're a guest with us today, right after the service, Pastor Ron will be in the coffee station area. It's just beyond the foyer and the breezeway. He'd love to greet you and give you a couple of things. And if you would, take the small white tab that's a part of your bulletin, fill out a little bit of information about yourself and your family, and that would be fantastic for us to have on file for you. Pray with me. Father, thank you so very much for a great morning of worship, for a stirring and encouraging and challenging message from your word, warning us about what happens when God's people don't care. God, rouse us, give us new hearts, new spirits, new minds. God, place your Holy Spirit in a mighty way in your church here at Myrtle Grove Baptist. Help us, oh God, to be a part of glorifying your name here on the west side of Pensacola, to making disciples, to proclaiming the freedom that we may have in your Son. I pray all this in Jesus' name.